guess I was just talking with you, not the other folks that are joining in. But again, with the propane question and the issue that we've all been facing in not only Ohio, but in about 25 other states, the real issue has been is that, how can we get the propane to the people out there that need it right now? And we've been contacted early on when things started hitting, and we wanted to make sure that we did as much as we possibly could. So, when we looked at the issues, people said, why is this happening, and how could it have happened? We've been having, probably the second coldest winter on recorded history is this winter. Again, last night at home, it was about 4 below 0 in spots. We had 45-mile-an-hour wind gusts last night, so, of course, that's going to make things a lot colder for folks. And, the different issues have been, we've had questions about on the export side to the net food, which is larger than in the years past. We've had issues with the crops last year needed a lot more drying. We had about 6 times more propane being used in crop drying. There's a question about pipelines, and so it was just kind of not wanting to use this term, but almost like the perfect storm that this occurred. So right off the bat, I know I've had meetings. I think George is on with us right now, and with other individuals, we've had calls into the district to talk to folks about how can we get propane out to people that need it right now. And so the different issues that we've had to address and look at right off the bat, and I had a very large meeting in my district, in my office here in Washington, and that dealt with, number one, how can we get the propane out? It was dealing with, on the transportation side, the refinery side. I mean, so we had everybody, all the players in the office at one time. One of the issues that we had to address right off the bat was, again, getting the propane to the folks that needed it, and the hours of service that drivers could drive had to be extended and upped. And so I wrote a letter to the Department of Transportation. We had all the members of Ohio's delegation join on that letter. So that's been now pushed until the 15th of March. There's a 30-day window that they're allowed to do this. So that window, unfortunately, is expiring on the 15th of this month. We're sending out another letter asking for another extension of 30 days. That's very important. I've signed on and voted for the bill that Chairman Schuster, who's the chairman of the Transportation and Infrastructure Committee, put through. And what that bill does is it gives a 90-day and not just a 30-day. So we'd extend it for 90 days. And that's over in the Senate. But we got to act now. And that's why we want the Department of Transportation to get to that next level for the next 30 more days. Because the outlook doesn't look good for the next week and a half at home for it even warming up that much. The other area is, of course, is we want to make sure that in committee that we've done, our work in committee, we had a hearing last week that we dealt with the questions about propane. One of the issues out there was on storage. We don't have enough storage capacity in the United States. I'm going to be having a meeting, in fact, later on today here with a couple of the departments. And one of the issues that's going to come up is about storage, because we just don't have the storage capacity where we need it. So we've had issues where we've had propane, but we couldn't get the propane where it had to be. So storage is a big issue. One other area, and I want to open it up to all of you, is that I've also written a letter to the president asking not only the question about the hours of service, but also that trucks can run heavier so they can get the propane out to where they need it right now. And so we have to, because I know listening to folks that have been out there trying to find it, they've been going down to Louisiana, Mississippi, Texas, driving the trucks down there, but we don't want trucks coming back light. We need them to have as much as possible. And so with that, if I could, if we could start the dialogue and the discussion, I'll turn it over to you right now. And I believe, who's the first to ask the question? I know that one of our participants has a meeting they might have to go to.
Diane.
So, Diane, if you can hear me, can't wait to hear from you.
Thank you, Congressman. I can hear you okay. We're over in Northwest Ohio, south of Bowling Green, and our biggest issue is that, like everybody just seemed to have woke up on January 20th, that, okay, we don't have any propane. We contracted for our propane back in August of 2013 and paid for 1,100 gallons of propane ahead. We expected to have delivery. We've never had a problem before. And then we get our delivery of propane in January, and they're only giving us 30%. The propane company, Prism, wanted us to monitor our tanks every day, go out in minus temperatures. They also tacked on the fuel charges of over $200 that we've had to pay additional, which is we're both on a fixed income. We're both retired. So that has really put a dent into our costs. We're having to pay tax on that propane, and on top of the fuel charge, we have to pay tax on top of it. We were asked to go out and get heaters at our expense, even though they were supposedly at cost. We have no other alternative heat source at our home. We had some kerosene heater as another alternative, and we've done everything to conserve our energy. So this has been a real frustration of, like, everybody seemed to have woke up one morning and realized we didn't have enough propane. So that's our biggest concern. Why is this going out of the country, I guess, is my other concern, why all this propane is going to being exported and not staying in the U.S. for the people that need it.
Well, and to go to a couple of your questions, the ships that were leaving the country actually were turned around and came back to the United States because to make sure that the propane stayed right here. But one of the issues we've had, again, is in all the discussions, is that we've had propane in the country, but we haven't had it in the right spots in some cases because it's down south. So we want to make sure that, first of all, this never happens again, because I know I got a letter from another, I think you're down in Bloomdale, if I remember.
That's correct, yes.
And that one of the things that, one of the letters I got from another constituent, that over on the eastern side of the district, that her husband's 96, and they've had to keep the temperature low, much lower than normal, that they would normally, because they've got to conserve. And so they've been bundling up. I know one of my cousins, I got a lot of cousins, but one of my cousins, he and his wife out in the country in Putnam County, they've really had to monitor, and I know that what happened was is that I know from talking to the companies, they wanted to make sure that, they would love to have been able to fill up everybody's tanks, but they wanted to make sure that everybody had enough to get through when they could, through these spells. And also, I know I've talked to farmers out there that they've had an issue because, especially if you've got livestock, chickens, turkeys, hogs, they've been very concerned about the livestock. And so, and then there's companies out there that need it for their factories in our more rural areas. So, again, unfortunately, this has been this winter of the perfect storm. One of the things this afternoon when I talked to the folks, the Department of Energy and also the Energy Information Agency, how do we make sure that we don't have this happen again in the future? But as I mentioned a little bit earlier, one of our problems has been there's multiple things, but another issue that's come up is we don't have the storage capacity. And I know we had the hearing that we had, I believe it was last week, sometimes my weeks kind of run together, but the one individual that testified was saying that, like up in New York, they would have the ability to help alleviate it more from happening if they had the storage. And up in their area, they've had problems getting that storage capacity and the permits and everything else. They have it there. So, again, we don't want this to ever happen again. We want to make sure that, every winter that everybody can, make sure that their heat's on in the house, that the livestock are taken care of. But we want to make sure that this, again, doesn't occur. So we want to make sure that we do have that energy in the right spot at the right time.
So are we going to have national propane reserves at some point? That's my question. Is there something out there? Or?
Right. That's the whole issue on the question of making sure that we have the storage. Part of it is the storage capacity. Because if we don't have the storage capacity, then, we're out of luck on it. Because we've got to have there in the right spots. The other issue is down the road, of course, is that we need to have, we have the great Utica Shale being found in eastern Ohio and Marcellus over in Pennsylvania, but we're going to also have to have more pipeline to be able to move that product from one spot to the other, because again, if we can have an abundance of it, but if we can't move it to where it has to be, we have a real problem.
Bob, if I could follow up.
Yeah, George, go right ahead.
It's George Walton. I also have our chairman of Prism Propane with us on this session. You know, our customer that just spoke, she's correct. We got into this issue, as you know, Bob, because we contacted you for some help. Most of the retail operations at that time were thrown in a position of where we couldn't get our gas, you know, that we had contracted for, because the suppliers, going back to what you said, Congressman, didn't have adequate storage, and they were out. We were told they were out, and they didn't know when they could get the gas to us, which forced us not only to have to go further out, like in Mississippi, you know, we were down in Alabama, Texas, Kansas City, all over where we could find the gas. It increased our transportation costs significantly, where, you know, we might be paying on a typical year, you know, anywhere between $1,000, you know, $800 to $1,000 for transportation, for a transport coming into our storage. We were paying anywhere from $4,000 to $10,000 per transport. And our board took the position that we're not going to touch the price per gallon. We were the cheapest in the market from the price per gallon compared to everyone that was charging $3 to $6 a gallon, where we had to, and we were forced. And our customers that have been with us long term know that our pricing has been pretty consistent each year until this year. We had to increase a delivery charge. And we capped it at $190 over the season. But again, it made us look bad to our customers. You know, but we had no other choice with the cost that we were incurring in bringing those loads in. My question that I'm going to follow up with this is the transportation end of it. Once we got into that crisis, we had even a very difficult time finding trucks, transport trucks. And when I tell you, I called every state that had decent-sized trucking companies, including Canada, who has trucking companies scattered throughout the, you know, sub-companies throughout the U.S. We ended up, through most of this crisis, only getting 3 transport trucks, 2 from one transport companies and 1 truck from another transport company. We had to do all type of things. There was no set days that we knew we had a truck to haul gas because we were going so far out to secure it. So, for example, in a typical week, I would call these 2 transport companies and say, do you have a truck that could maybe haul gas from Alabama to our storage locations? And they may tell me, you know, they would come back and say, well, we may be able to get one on Thursday or Friday to dispatch to that location. And so it really created a bad situation, not only for the retail companies, but a very difficult situation for the rural members that use propane out there. And it really put a black eye on the retail operations. So if there's anything that, Bob, in some of your work, which you did a great job, and you basically saved a lot of these retail operations through your efforts of extending hours of service, that was crucial for us dropping a couple of hundred gallons a drop out to our customers. You know, getting gas flowing back through the Enterprise pipeline and turning ships around, had it not been for that, we would have ran people out of gas. When I brought those heaters in, as our customer explained, we had no other choice. We had 5,000 gallons in our 250,000 gallons of storage when our suppliers told us that they couldn't honor our contracts, couldn't deliver on them. And so thinking quick, you know, our board and I decided to secure some heaters and at least make them available to our customers in case we ran out of gas and couldn't supply it to them. So transportation is a big issue under a crisis-type situation, is making sure there's adequate transport trucks that can haul the gas from further out into our storage.
Well, your issue of having adequate trucks and also for rail, you know, I think with rail, just to build the tanks themselves, it's around, I think, 18-plus months to get the tanker on the rail side, and then, of course, on the truck side, to get those ordered way in advance. So, again, I think our issue has been not only that we didn't have the gas in the right spot, but also the question is we didn't have the trucks that we could, because as you said, that you're hauling quite a distance down south to climb the gas and have to bring that back, and that's why the hours of service to get that extended is so important for your people then to get that gas out to be able to deliver it. And then the other was the issue of making sure that we had that vehicles could run a little bit heavier, and that's what we're asking for right now. And, you know, if I could, I'd like to, if Melinda, if you'd like to ask a question or make some comments, that would be greatly appreciated.
Hi, Bob. I was wondering, well, my nephew and his family also had the same problems as Diane. They were told their tank was less than 10%. They weren't getting gas. And they were locked in at 289, but before they were able to get gas, the price had went up to 529. And I understand that with the cold winter and all that, that it is difficult, but I'm wondering if there's any way we could have a reactive program and do something reactive, since we can't do it proactive anymore because we're in it, but if there's a way to get for people with, like, retired people, people on limited income, to help them with their weatherization.
Mm-hmm.
So when, if we have another winter like we did this time, it won't be so bad. They won't use so much. They won't lose as much heat loss. You know, they won't have as many drafts or anything that we can come up with to help them. Because I know that with us just moving, we have fuel oil. And we don't have a problem with getting it because not many people use it. We used $1,600 last year. And so far, we've used $2,400 worth this year. And we're going to have to order more before the end of the winter. And I know that I know the problems with this house, and we haven't had a chance to get it weatherized yet or winterized, but it'll probably take us all summer to do it to where we don't have the drafts and the heat loss next year. Is there anything that you can do to help those of us out here in the middle of nowhere kind of conserve what we have to, what we get, so we don't use it as fast?
State of Ohio, we have the HEAP, I think it's HEAP program, and I know that we've come when people have contacted us, it's more from the state to make the inquiries and see if we can get them to the right people, and especially in the counties, because that's where it'd be administered. And so if you want, you know, contact, you can contact us as you can on the local level, who we get you in contact with about that. I know years ago, the first house my wife and I had, we did every window we had in the house, we had to put the plastic on with the hair dryer to seal out the air that was coming through. Because I know that a lot of houses, that air is going to come right through there, and you're going to lose a lot of heat that way. But if you've got a pen handy or something, or you can just go online, but our toll-free number is 800-541-6446, 800-541-6446, and if you haven't got one right now, but, you know, you might, before we get done, I'll give you that number again, but, you know, it's important because, as you said, that, you use a lot more of this cold weather, and especially when we've had this severe winter that we've had. It's just it's been absolutely brutal out there. And, you know, good Lord willing that sometime next week we're going to get out of the cycle and slowly start seeing the temperatures warm up. But I believe it's HEAP. But, again, contact us. We'll also be in contact for you and the county for you.
Mr. Latta, can I make a last comment because I'm going to have to leave?
Oh, sure. Absolutely.
Okay. The only thing I would want to say was that this whole propane, I know we're going to have crisis and we have shortages, but it seemed like between the propane company and the customer, we were the only people that seemed to be having, we were out there on our own. I even talked to emergency management in Wood County and nobody seemed to know what kind of plan there was going to be for if we ran out of heat and where we were going to go. They said stay with relatives. Well, we don't have any close relatives. And it seems like we were on the burden of having to put out money to get heaters. It seems to me that emergency management should have been able to help us with extra heat source or help to get us these heaters at no cost. So we have a lot of additional expenses incurred. This is, you know, calamities happen out there, but I think it's how we handle them and how we react to them is the big issue.
Well, in this way, you know, the hearing that we had in the past week, we don't want this ever to repeat it. We want to make sure that the propane's out there, but again, we want to make sure that it's really making sure that we've got the propane in where it needs to be in the country, and make sure that, again, part of the problem, as I know that Mr. Walton already said, but and we've heard in the committee, is that we've got to have better storage capacity where we need it in the country. And again, like up in New York State, they didn't have the storage up there that they had to have. And why is it that we were not getting that storage? And so we want to make sure, again, this never happens again. Never.
I agree with you. I mean, there should have been backup reserves somewhere out there, and that didn't seem to be there for the people and for the companies.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bob?
Yes. Go right here.
Dave Corbin from PRISM. I wanted to say a couple things. The storage, as far as that goes, is a great idea. But I see that as more of a longer-term thing because we're talking about immensely amount of storage because whenever it gets cold, we're just taking so much gas, it's impossible to have enough storage probably. But I also see two other short-term problems that we could fix. Maybe I'm not sure if you guys got any jurisdiction on the exporting the gas to other countries. Would we have to pay a little bit more? I suppose they're getting more money. I don't know that. But I don't know if you guys got any control on the export. That's number one. And the second thing that really hurt us bad was the pipelines. When them pipelines shut down, that is our heart. That is where everything comes from, is them pipelines. And when they shut down, they was using natural gas instead of propane. That's what really shot us in the foot. So I think them two things are big issues on near term. On longer term, I agree with you 100% more storage.
Well, and again, you know, there's that whole issue about what happened with the pipelines. I believe we've got to have more pipelines out there, make sure that you don't have the problem of the gas going from point A to point B and then going out to the other areas where it might have to go. So, you know, pipelines are absolutely essential. We've got to have, first of all, A, the pipeline is running the supply that we have. I know that we had the questions that came up early on. It was some of this other gas is going through the pipelines, that they were putting through. There was they had been contracted because they had to get gas someplace else, a different type of gas at the same time we're trying to get propane through that we had to have in our own backyard in Ohio. And so I think that, you know, that's been an issue. And on the question of the on export, again, why is it this year all of a sudden that we had a much greater amount of propane that had been exported? As a question I haven't gotten answered yet, but, you know, I think it was great that we were able that, you know, the two ships that I know of that were out heading to sea did come back to the United States with their loads. So, and I know one went up into the New England area and the other one, I think, was more on the East Coast someplace, but at least we had the ability to keep that gas right here then. But it comes down to, we just got to have, it's a whole multiple thing, as you said, that, you know, it's not only just the storage, but it's everything that happened this year at one time that had never happened, I guess, probably in the past. And, you know, we were finding that how long it takes now to have a tanker truck out there to be able to get that load or get that tanker truck constructed, or a tank car on a rail, or, you know, we have to make sure that we don't have to keep going through these hours of service extensions so, you know, the gas can be delivered to people when they need it, because we don't want people having to go out and keep checking the propane tank to see how low it is every day. Or that's, you know, for a lot of people, especially when we had the amount of snow that we had and the cold that we had and the drifting that we had, I don't want people going out there, especially our senior citizens that would, you know, have to experience that real cold weather. And so we want to, that's why, like today, just by coincidence, we are having another meeting in my office that, you know, to go over these issues to make sure that we can go forward with some solutions.
Well, Bob, I might come back with, I wonder if we don't get the pipeline, I wonder if there's any possible way, like next year, say, give propane 2 weeks, then give natural gas, stagger it back and forth or something. Because this year, it just, boom, it stopped, and we didn't get no more. In other words, we had several places that we was going to get it, and they called back, and they said, sorry, pipeline shut down, we don't have no more. I don't know, but it seems like something's going to have to be worked in near term on this pipeline situation. Because that cuts the travel of the trucks down. That helps a lot of things if we can get pipeline, because we can get a lot closer. So you don't have to run to Texas. You don't have to run to Georgia, you know.
Well, and those, again, it's not only that when we had the committee hearing, but also the questions that we're raising right now to find out how we can make sure that doesn't occur again in the pipeline or the delivery from truck or, you know, you name it. That propane is where it's got to be right now, and not 1,000 miles away or 1,200 miles away, but right in our right northwest Ohio or one of the 26 states that needed it. Just didn't seem to be where it had to be at the time. So, we're as I said this afternoon, I'm going to be meeting with the energy information folks and also with the Department of Energy, and any ideas or other suggestions, please let me know. And again, for the question out there about the heat, if you just give me a call at 1-800-541-6446, and we can get back in touch with you on that. So I really appreciate your time.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob, and thanks for everything you're doing for us.
Thank you.
I really appreciate Bob.